the general manager of the New York Mets, Brody Van Wagenen, joins us. Brody, good to talk to you. How you been?
I'm doing great, guys. It's been an interesting few months, but I'm glad we're back at it. That's for sure.
Interesting, to say the least. It's got to be an interesting last 4 or 5 days. How has it gone so far with summer camp at Citi Field?
Well, we're at Citi Field. We've got 51, 52 players that we've had up here, which really has never been done, at least on my side before, trying to juggle stations and staggered workouts and moving people around. But the guys have had a lot of fun, and we've been able to get all of our work in, and, you know, a unique environment. But at the same point, it's been a lot of fun to see everybody going to work.
We've heard so much about lags in testing results where other teams have had to cancel workouts. Has everything gone well in terms of testing and everything you need to do right now?
Well, knock on wood, I know our players have been incredibly cooperative and focused more on getting back to this situation where we have an optimistic mind. We want to play. And so putting ourselves in a position to execute all the protocols and then working within Major League Baseball's rules and working with the testers, so far so good. I think we've been pleased with the timeline, the process, and ready to continue. Now it feels a little bit more normal now that the intake testing is done, but so far in Mets camp, it's been a pretty good routine.
You know, we've seen, I guess it's now 9 guys decide not to play this year, and it's completely understandable given the circumstances. Did you almost feel like, hey, I want to call the guys, make sure everybody's on board, talk to guys if guys are on the fence? Did you almost have to self-recruit your own guys to see where their heads were in terms of playing this year?
Well, our communication never really stopped with the guys. Through this whole shutdown, I know Luis and Jeremy Hefner and the entire coaching staff, the performance department had been in weekly, if not daily, contact with these guys, and we knew how hard they were working and how much they were preparing to get back into camp, obviously not knowing when that day was going to come. So we didn't really get any sense from our guys that there was apprehension, and, you know, we'll continue to make sure that they're as comfortable as possible. But, you know, we knew that there was enthusiasm from the guys, so we didn't really have to necessarily recruit it. We just tried to keep the communication organic about how to prepare, and we've been fortunate that everybody has wanted to play and is here. So hopefully that can continue.
So nobody was, at least in talking to you, maybe with their family, but nobody talked about the idea of not playing, is what you're saying. Everybody was fully on board?
Not with the organization, right? I mean, I think the players, all we heard, and Luis kept telling me this over and over again, and he had regular Zoom calls with smaller groups of players, with the entire team, calls going out to individual players on a regular basis. The constant word he kept saying to me was excited. These guys are excited. They want to play, and they're working as hard as they possibly can to be ready whenever the light goes on. And so once we got word that we had a report date, it was just a matter of mobilizing everybody and getting them here, and the rest has been off and running.
All right, so here's the million-dollar question, and I think this is the number one question Met fans have been asking for months. Is Yoenis Cespedes going to play on opening day?
That's only $1 million question?
Okay, $50 million. Well, how much you paying him now? You got him to take a big pay cut, so it's less than that, right?
You know, I don't know how much coverage, you know, has been shown live of him, you know, here over the course of the last couple of days. But the time off just allowed him to get stronger, allowed him to make some of his running progressions, move forward at a good pace. And so he's in a much better position than when we broke camp back on March 16th. He's swinging the bat. He's running, at a pretty high exertion level. He played left field in a sim game the other day. So it's just going to be a continued management of his workload, continue to build him up so that he can handle, you know, not only, you know, 1 day, but 2 days in a row, 3 days in a row. And those are the tests that we'll try to put him through as we build up towards opening day.
So what are your expectations? Do you think he plays? And playing every day is a lot. I don't know how many guys are going to play every day, but do you see him playing 4 times a week, 5 times a week? Well, what's your expectation for him?
It's so hard to speculate on how many days a week. What I can tell you from what we've seen here is he's really swinging the bat well. He's moving great. He's been in a position where his legs are under him in a way that we haven't seen since he got injured. And that's exciting. And, you know, we'll continue to hope that continues and gets better, because he can help us in a pretty meaningful way.
Well, you mentioned the videos. I've seen a couple of videos. When I saw him run, I was nervous. It was like I was watching my three-year-old run. Like, you get nervous, he's going to fall down and hurt himself. So that was my first emotion, watching him run. But then we all got to see him play first base, or at least work out at first base. Is that something on the table, that Yoenis may actually play a little first base this year?
Well, I think that was actually more of a small group session where he was catching balls from infielders throwing across the diamond. So he has always liked to take ground balls at third base, at shortstop. He's obviously done a little bit of work at first base, and you saw today, but this was more about picking up the slack as we're staggering workouts and having fewer people on site at any given point in time than actually preparing him for an opening day start. I think we know who's going to be at first base if everything goes smoothly.
Do you look at him and say, you know what, just DH this year? Or, because you mentioned he's working out in left field, and, you know, jokes aside, that's his position. Do you foresee him playing a lot of left field, more so at DH? What do you expect in that regard?
What we know this year is that we're not going to be able to predict much of anything in terms of, you talked about guys playing every day. We're in a 60-game season. We've got guys that are different points of fitness as they've come into camp based on the solutions they had working out-wise before they got here. And we just got to be careful in terms of how often we play guys, what we ask them to do. And, you know, in his position, when he's right, he's a very good defensive player that can add to the club, not just with his bat, but also with his glove. It's just too early to tell how often we ask him to do that. And obviously the makeup of the team is going to dictate that to a large degree.
But this predates you. It's always been the case with Yoenis, and Joe and I have talked about this a lot. Joe is certainly passionate about it. I'm less so, but I understand where he's coming from. And that's the idea that Cespedes has a gun in right field. He has this incredible arm, and yet he's always been reluctant to play right field. He's always been a left fielder. Has that ever been something you've talked to him about? Like, hey, you know, right field actually suits you best with the arm that you have.
Yeah, for us, I mean, he signed here as a left fielder, and then over the course of the last year and a half, he hasn't, as you know, been able to play the outfield at all.
He's done nothing.
Right now, our focus is trying to put him in a position where he's most comfortable. So the more variables we can take off the table, the better. But you're right, he's got a bazooka for an arm.
All right, Jed Lowry. He is that when he answers that, hey, what's up with you? And he says, I don't want to create a distraction. That creates a distraction because it creates this idea of, well, what's happened to Jed Lowry? You sign him a year ago, and I can't even rip you for it, Brody, because I agree with it. I was like, hey, guy's coming off a good year. Why not? You got versatility. The guy's 0-for-8 as a Met. He's got this brace on constantly. Can you reveal what the heck happened with Jed Lowry?
Well, we've talked about this a lot. You know, he's dealt with a knee issue, you know, going back to even before spring training started, or the first week of spring training, that, you know, cost him the whole season. And, you know, he kind of had whole left side of his body was impacted, and ultimately he wasn't able to go at full strength last year. And I think as he's worked through this course of the off season, and then as he came into spring training and even since then, strengthening that knee has been his priority, and getting to a point where he's able to strengthen the knee and then also transition to a functional brace that'll allow him to compete in games. And so far in summer camp here, he's been able to play in the field, similar like Cespedes. He's been able to bat unrestricted from both sides of the plate. He's been in these sim games. And, you know, the real test will be as he starts to continue his running progression in terms of how, you know, how effective he can be and at what pace he can run. But the early response from him and the way he's responded to the work that he's been putting himself through is encouraging. And, you know, I think that's probably the most optimistic I've been about him in a long time.
We're talking to Brody Van Wagenen, the GM of the New York Mets. Summer camp is fully underway. Opening day just a couple of weeks away. How do you feel about this team as compared to going into a 162? Because it's different. We're dealing with a 60-game season. We're dealing with so many variables that are tough to predict. Do you feel the same way coming into this shortened season as you did going into the 162?
It is different. There's no question about it. The biggest difference I see is that over 162, there's a belief that the roster that was constructed in the offseason is going to be the roster for the most part of your team. Now, guys may spend a 2-week stint on an IL where guys are going to go through streaks and slumps and things of that nature. But over the course of 162 games, it's going to balance out, and the playing time typically sort of falls into place for where guys have previously been. When you're in 60 games, all bets are off. Hot streaks effectively become a season. You know, cold streaks can become a season. You know, guys' health, if you miss some time, whether it's on a COVID IL or whether it's, you know, any other soft tissue injury, you know, you're missing half the season potentially. So the mindset that we've tried to create here is we're going to have adversity. There's no question. And the adversity is not going to be, hey, we're going to be able to overcome it over 162. It's going to be next man up here, now, let's produce, because every game is, you know, value of every game is magnified.
So does that lower the bar in a way, raise the bar, or keep the bar the same?
I think it keeps the pressure on. You know, the bar of, you know, from a roster standpoint, is constantly trying to find ways to add depth because we're going to need it. Every team's going to need it. So how can we do that? You saw we added a couple of names here that we didn't have in spring training with us before, you know, in spring training 1.0 that we brought in. And, you know, we're going to want to try to populate that player pool with as many good players as possible so that when they are called upon, and whether that's on opening day or whether that's at some point thereafter, that these guys have the ability to step right in and get a big hit in a big spot. And some of the guys we've added have done that previously, you know, in their career.
I've been so curious about this, that a pitcher doesn't pitch well out of the bullpen. You know, you send them down and you call up somebody else who's pitching well at AAA. You reward them for their success. Now AAA is just working out in Brooklyn, essentially. That's your minor league system. Does that make you forget injuries and COVID? I'm talking about performance-based promotions, sending a guy down, calling a guy up. Does that make it less likely to call a guy up? Because if, you know, Walker Lockett, I hate to use him as an example, but, you know, he's working out in Brooklyn. There's no performance, really, other than intra-squad games to say, hey, he's pitching well, let me call him up, he can really help our bullpen. So does that change your philosophy on calling guys up, sending guys down during the course of a season like this?
I don't know if it changes the philosophy, because a lot of times need is going to be driving a lot of those decisions. And particularly in the bullpen, where, you know, if guys are either overused to the point where they threw too many pitches in a particular outing and we need to find somebody else to replace them, or if performance dictates it, it's going to be our job to try to replicate intensity as best as we can in Brooklyn and create a competitive environment, and then track that. You know, we're tracking it both in terms of statistics and trying to say, okay, while these are still small sample sizes, what does the data tell us? You know, what are the exit velocities? What's the pitcher spin rate? What's the pitch movement and all those types of things, while also simulating games in pitcher-batter confrontations as close to real life as we can, even though it will never be real life. But the stakes are high because these guys are competing with each other for that spot. And then, of course, if they're here, they're going to want to keep that spot as time goes on.
What's your feeling? And it's funny thinking back to early March, oh, the Mets have six guys in the rotation. What are you going to do? And I remember thinking something, unfortunately, is going to happen. I mean, you'd rather have depth. Somebody's going to get hurt. Unfortunately, it turned out to be Noah, but you've got Waka, Porcello, Stroman, Jake. You've got your five guys, Steven Matz. You got your five guys. How do you feel about the starting pitching depth behind that with Peterson and Lockett and Oswalt? Those are the guys I assume that would pick up the mantle, but how do you feel right now about that starting pitching depth going into this season?
Yeah, you didn't mention two names that I would add to that group. I think you had the right guys. I think you mentioned add Lugo, add Gesellman to that mix, as guys that, you know, we're hoping to be building up to multi-inning guys to start the year. Whether those multi-innings come in the bullpen or late in games, like the way Lugo was used last year, and same for Rob, those guys, if we needed them, could transition into, you know, a starter role and potentially build up innings while in season to pick up that slack as well. But, you know, we do have some options, and I know Peterson's an exciting guy. He was lights out in spring training. Lockett, we do believe, has the chance to be a major league starter and to be more consistent than he was last year if he had greater opportunity. But, you know, we do feel like, you know, Corey Oswalt had a great year in AAA. We think we've got some guys, but the real question is, can we have them ready? You mentioned about it earlier before. Hopefully we have these five guys for the gauntlet, but if we don't, we got to have these guys ready to pick up right away. You know, our depth in the bullpen is something else that may afford us the opportunity to move a Lugo or a Gesellman or a Lockett, you know, guys that might be in the bullpen to start the year. It allows us to move them in because we may have guys that can pitch the 6th, 7th, 8th, and 9th in a pretty high octane way.
Well, let me go back to Lugo, because that's interesting. The reason I left him out is, it shows what happens when you assume. You're you-know-what, which I guess I am. I think of him as so important in the back end of that bullpen. He had a great year last year. I mean, of all the guys in this bullpen, he was the best one. When you talk about him being a starter, would it be, oh, he could pitch two or three innings, he's sort of an opener, or could he be stretched out to where he's a traditional starting pitcher, where he's going six innings into a game? How would you view this potential universe where Seth Lugo's starting games?
It'll depend on at what point in the season that transition starts. You know, if it were today, then we could build him up to, like some of these other guys that you're seeing, be able to get to three, maybe four innings if we needed to come opening day. Now, if it comes August 1st or if it comes September 1st, then clearly it's going to be a shorter innings limit here or for him to start the game. But I think because it's 60 games, and not only does every game count more, but every inning does. And so sure. I think you'll see guys deployed wherever and whenever they need to try to get that out in that situation, even if it's in a different inning than they've typically been used. I think we have enough weapons that guys can come in, match up, and not necessarily be pigeonholed. I heard you guys talking before the break just mm-hmm. about who the closer was going to be.
Right.
I think we're going to be using these guys in the most important spots based on who's available that day, who's going right. We're going to, in some ways, we're going to ride the wave more this year than ever have before.
I love that. And I've always thought that as a baseball fan, like why name a closer? Based on the matchups, based on how a guy's pitching, that's how you should go. Is there any, the feedback I've always heard from guys in baseball is, well, relievers really need to know their roles. They need to know seventh inning, eighth inning. Do you not think that that's as necessary? Like, could a guy like Betances, Diaz, Lugo, they're comfortable pitching, getting a big out in the sixth. They're comfortable getting a big out in the ninth. Like, it doesn't matter. They don't need to know the inning role that they supposedly have.
Historically, I've been a believer of the former, of if guys know, generally speaking, when they're going to be throwing so they can prepare throughout the day and, position themselves over the 162, like you talked about before. I've always felt that was important. Mm-hmm. But we only got 60 games. And so these guys are going to be pitching when they're available in the most important spots. And I think they all recognize that. And more than that, they're looking forward to the opportunity. All these guys have wanted to play. Now they get to go. And they're racehorses. They want to go grab the ball and want to go.
So there's not going to be a closer this year. Guys, four or five guys may get saves throughout the season. There's no official closer for the 2020 Mets.
Yeah, I wouldn't put that label on it. And obviously that's ultimately going to be Luis's move on each of those given days. But we're not going to have Betances, Diaz, Lugo, Familia, Wilson, Gesellman, all available every night. And so we're going to have to, like I said, deploy these guys in the most meaningful spot when we have them, and let's try to use them as much as possible while keeping them healthy and keeping them effective.
Yeah, the thing about Lugo last year that was great and frustrating at the same time is he can go get six outs. He can go get more than that, and he did that a lot of times, but then he wouldn't be available for stretches of time. Do you think that's going to be kind of the same thing? Like, if he goes out and pitches two innings in a game, he's probably not going to pitch for a couple of days, or are the restrictions changing in a year like this with him?
I expect that he's going to have more guys around him that can be as effective as he was last year that can help pick up some of that load. And, we were in a stretch last year also trying to win every game that if we had a lead late in the game and it was four outs, five outs, six outs, seven outs, Seth was going to be in that game if he was available. And, right. Sometimes that many wasn't available the next day, but he was available in September, more frequently for back-to-back days. It's just the situations called for him to go get those extra outs. I think with the guys we have this year, we can use him, in more games, not necessarily having to go multi-innings in every single game.
And you feel good about Edwin Diaz, because as you can imagine, there's a lot of worry from Met fans on which Edwin Diaz is going to show up, because look, he was good for the first few months of the year. It really changed that Dodger game, that West Coast debacle, which I still have nightmares about, Brody. That's where it all changed for him. Before that, he was pitching well. You feel good about Edwin coming into this year?
I do. He worked so hard. I think he grew up a lot last year just in terms of facing adversity for the first time really ever in his career and doing it with a new team and a new uniform. It was a lot to throw at him, but his talent is there. He still struck out, 98, 99 guys last year. Guys have a you know, he can take the ball out of play with a strikeout. What we saw is his progression in spring training, and then what we saw, if he can be, you know, anything close to what he was the other day out here in his first outing, you know, we're going to have a special reliever on our hands again, and I know everybody's excited to see it.
We're talking to Brody Van Wagenen. We know Jake looks just completely ready for opening day. I think Steven Matz said recently he's way ahead of schedule. He was throwing a lot. Where are we with Porcello and Waka and Stroman in terms of when this season starts and they're in the rotation, how deep they'll be able to pitch right away?
Well, it's funny you mentioned what Matz said about Jake. Jake gushed about Matz every bit as much the next day. And I think these guys are all seeing what we've noticed is the pitchers right now are ahead of the hitters. The buildup that these guys had in spring training and the maintenance that they had with their arm care and their workload, they've been ready hoping that they would be starting the season and prepared to go multi-innings all the way back into June 1st. So I think the pitchers are in a good spot to where, you know, these guys are going to be in a position to come out of the gate with, if not full starts or full pitch count expectation, pretty darn close to it. But Porcello threw the ball well the other day. Stroman threw two innings yesterday. Waka got his first inning, you know, first outing under his belt with three innings. So these guys will be ready. I think if we can keep people healthy, then I don't have any doubt that those guys will be ready from a pitch count and a workload standpoint.
What is your official position on the DH? We know the DH is happening in 2020, totally understand it. But long term, now, you've been in this sport for a while as an agent, now as a GM. Are you pro-DH in the National League, or are you a fan of the pitcher can hit in the National League, keep the DH in the AL?
You know, it's similar to like what I said about the reliever roles. I am, by nature, a traditionalist. I like the strategy of the National League game. I've always loved the purity of baseball in that way. But over the last few years, you know, whether it was guys that I represented or whether it's now guys that, you know, that I work with on this side of the table, great pitchers, you don't want to see them get hurt running the bases or diving back into first base on a pickoff play, or, you know, trying to execute a bunt and a ball comes up the bat and breaks a finger. You know, pitchers are so valuable, and I'd like to see them stay as healthy as possible for as long as possible. And, you know, if we do make that change, the byproduct is we're pretty well positioned for the DH given some of the bats that we have. So there's a silver lining to all this. I like how it plays out for us.
I was going to say, I mean, there's an advantage, and I think everybody has felt this way. And look, personally, I'm pro pitcher hitting, but I understand that this team is built better to have the DH. I totally get that. I'm sure that's got to factor in a little bit, knowing, looking ahead with Robbie Cano signed for the next few years, that it doesn't hurt having the DH for the New York Mets.
No, it doesn't. It doesn't hurt. And, you know, I'm sure a lot of teams feel that way, that if you've got depth and you've got talent, then, you know, wouldn't it be great to put them in the lineup more often? And this year for us, it's probably going to be more important because you made the comment earlier, you can't expect people to play nine innings in the field every day after, you know, missing three months since we were all last together. So I think we can utilize it that way. A lot of guys will get DH spots. My guess is you won't see us have the same nine guys batting in the same order every day, you know, for the 60 games. It's going to be rotating guys through to make sure everybody's fresh. And, you know, when we get into September, hopefully then it's all systems go and we got the core guys going.
Have you guys been studying all the possibilities about what to do in the 10th inning, whether you're on the road or you're at home, who's on second base? Because this new rule, which, you know, personally I'm not a fan of, but we got to live with it. It's the rule. It's going to probably factor in a lot whenever there's a tie game, obviously, in extra innings. Have you guys given incredible thought to all the different scenarios you may have to deal with this new rule?
We really have, and I think there's the data and what's more valuable, a runner on second base with no outs or a runner on third base with one out. You know, we do a lot of that stuff even before this rule came into play. You know, we game theoried a lot of these situations in the off season and going through spring training, and you know, now that we know we're going to be in those situations every time we go to extra innings. It's not only the odds or the percentages, but you're also looking at who on the roster is going to be in that position, right? If Wilson Ramos makes the last out of the inning, who's going to be running out there at second base in an extra inning game? And those are fun things that I know Louis is going to look forward to. He's a strategy guy and he likes running a game in the moment. But you know, he was thinking of double switches. Now he's going to be looking at, you know, how to utilize the roster and pinch running situations and, you know, pitcher-batter matchups more so than having to worry about a double switch.
It's funny, while I was down there months ago, one of the guys that jumped out at me, who I was not familiar with at all, was this, and if I'm pronouncing his name wrong, certainly correct me, Joanishwi Fargas, right?
Mm-hmm.
This guy, and then I'm watching him play. I was like, I'm not familiar with this guy. And I saw he had 50 stolen bases last year in a world in which, stolen bases have gone away. Does this rule almost give a better chance for a guy like Fargas, who I don't think is on a lot of people's radar, to make the team so you can almost have that specialized pinch runner in the right circumstances in these extra inning situations?
There's no question. I think guys like that around the league, and he, if you watched him in spring training, we challenged him to be super aggressive. We said, okay, run more. If you get thrown out, it's okay. We want to have guys taking more chances. Cordell's a similar guy, real athletic player, can really run, can play defense. Both of those guys give us a different element that I think is helpful. And the same thing goes for defensive players. When you have guys that can really defend, Jake Mariznick, obviously, is we brought in to play center field at an elite level. Andrés Giménez has been in camp both at spring and here, can really catch the baseball. And, on a roster where you got some extra spots, you can start the game one way and you can finish it in a very different way.
We're talking to Brody Van Wagenen, and usually the trade deadline is something that, is on everybody's mind and you're incredibly busy. What do you think, August 31st, in a season like this, what do you think the trade deadline is going to look like?
It really depends on where a team is in the standings. We know that we're in first place right now, but we're also in last place right now. A lot of things are going to get clarified over the course of the first 30 games of the season. And, we expect and want to be on the positive side of that grouping and be in a position to where we're going for it. And, naturally the deadline being pushed back is going to force people to reassess how important a 30-game stretch is versus a 60-game stretch the way it was before, and the impact that that's going to be on your organization going forward. We've been willing to make trades for winning now, and I think we'll always have that mindset of putting the best team on the field that we can now while still keeping an eye strategically on what we can look like down the road. Having a shorter season makes us at least have to think about the risk versus reward appetite at that point in time.
Any relationship with Steve Cohen? He owns, 8% of the team? The Mets are for sale. It's out there that there's going to be an auction. Do you have any relationship with Steve Cohen?
the relationship that I'm focused on right now is the Luis Rojas, the players, the Wilpon family. My daily activity, really, through any of the noise that is a potential sale, has been, keep my head down, do the job. Jeff Wilpon and I, we have 7 conversations a day. Fred and I are in constant communication. We go to work, and anything else that distracts us from trying to win baseball games right now is something that I don't let us really focus on or get in our way. And I know the players and the coaching staff feel the same way.
Well, win some games. We're all excited for the baseball season to come back. Can't wait. And I appreciate you coming on, Brody. Thank you.
All right, guys. Always enjoy it. Thanks for the support. We'll look forward to. I wish we could see you guys out here more.
I know. Trust me. Yeah. Trust me. I wish that too, man. Next year, we'll see you in 2021.
Hopefully, we can entertain you on TV.
That's the key. Thank you, Brody.
Right.
I appreciate it.
All right, guys. Bye bye.
Brody Van Wagenen, the general manager of the New York Mets. We'll come back at your calls 877-337-6666. And a couple interesting things he said, specifically the lack of a closer this year, which I absolutely love to hear. I have been screaming about that for years.